when the shell has barely cracked, the only person who feels a blow, a punch in the stomach when you get that 1 out of 5 on Zomato or a 1 out of 5 on TripAdvisor, it's the founder, it's you. Your employees won't care as much. Not yet, not when your business is so small. I learned this lesson too late. End of 2016, my newly hired CA gave me some really bad news. He said, Munaf, there's something called VAT and you haven't paid it. The total VAT liability, which was a fairly small amount, was equal to my personal savings. So for the first time in my life, I was bankrupt, personally. So on one end, I have a 1 out of 5 on Zomato. On another end, I'm bankrupt. I decided I'm going to quit the body kitchen. I can't do this anymore. And then I get a phone call. The phone call is from the guys at Forbes. They're like, Munaf, you're so successful. We want to put you on the Forbes 30 under 30 list. We think you're one of the top 30 entrepreneurs in this country under the age of 30, and we are betting on you. I did one of the dumbest things I've ever done in my life. I said, why? Because I'm not successful. And the person on the phone, what he told me literally gets me through some of the hardest times I face today, till day. He told me, Munaf, we're putting you on the list, not because you are an incredibly successful entrepreneur who's making millions. We are putting you on the list and we're putting you on the cover because we feel what you are doing, if you succeed, you will disrupt the space. The concept of home dining experiences, we feel, really has the potential to change the way the industry operates. Now, entrepreneurship is a thing where you do fail. It happens, unfortunately. But if you succeed, you're going to kill it, brother. So they put me on the list and I said, thank you. And I told myself that if Forbes believes in me, who am I to question myself? So I went into 2017 with a completely different mindset. I decided to visit the kitchen more often. I learned how to make biryani in my house. It was probably the worst week in my mother's life. I started spending more time with the team. I literally relearned accounting. I realized that the home dining experience, that is probably the single most biggest asset that the Bori Kitchen has. Delivery is important, catering is important, but home dining is where the potential really lies. Journalists kept on coming to my house. They kept on asking me, Munaf, what's your vision with TBK? My answer remained the same. I really, really want Shah Rukh Khan to come, eat my food. The difference is, when I said this in 2015, I said it with a very, like it's not going to happen. When I say it now, when I say it today, I say it knowing it will happen. It will take 6 months, it will take 12 months, but I'm 110% certain it's going to happen. Why? Because half of Bollywood's already come to my house. Okay, we've had Farah Khan, Ashutosh Gowarikar, Sanjay Leela Bansali, Hrithik Roshan, Rishi Kapoor, Rani Mukherjee, Aditya Chopra. If they haven't come home, they've invited us to their homes because they wanted mom samosas. So yeah, Shah Rukh should come. But I have a slightly more serious vision with TBK. Now the vision is, it's a slightly MBA vision. It's to take Bori food across the world. And it's with immense pride that I feel that we are actually taking steps towards this direction. In 2018, very recently in March, we were awarded the Times Food Award for the best Bori food restaurant. And we are not a restaurant. We are a home dining experience. We invite 30 people at most in a week to my house. That was enough to win this award. Just imagine that. 2018, I think the biggest development that I've had in my personal life is I've finally maybe matured a little bit and moved from chief eating officer to a CEO of a food business that's actually trying to do something significant. But a bigger development really is that I've discovered the potential for tourism and home dining experiences. The Bori Kitchen in its 2 to 3 years has come on the top 10 in TripAdvisor amongst 14,000 restaurants that are listed in Bombay. Try to understand this. We don't have a physical space where you can walk in. We barely feed 30 people in a week. That also when we are in the mood to do that. It's not a business goal to invite people home. That was enough to get us on the top 10. That's how powerful a home dining experience is. On the top left, you have guys from the US consulate who came, who had heard about us. On the top right, you have these incredibly powerful German expats who are eating chicken drumsticks in this photo. But I'd like to talk to you guys about one very interesting group that came very recently. This is 32 students of Columbia Business School who came to my house a couple of weeks back. That's my mom on the left. And they didn't want to come. This was their last day in India. None of them wanted to go to somebody's house and eat food. They'd rather go to a fancy hotel or a restaurant or whatever. But one of the students, Parijat, that was her name, she had come to my house 2 years back with her family, and she insisted, she dragged these 32 students to my house, Columbia Business School. A few of these students came to me at the end of the meal, at the end of the experience, and they told me, Munaf, we spent 25 days in India. We visited every single location we are supposed to. We've gone to Taj Mahal in Agra. We visited some of the biggest restaurants. We've been to some of the biggest and most exciting experiences. We even visited Dharavi for some reason in Bombay. But the 2.5 hours that we spent in your house, where your mom and your dad served us food, where you spoke about the Dawoodi Bohra community, where you bothered to take us through what this food stands for, what is the idea of the Bohri Thal, where we experienced Indian hospitality in its true and raw form for the very first time, this, Munaf, was far more powerful than anything else we did in these 25 days. When they said this, I had goosebumps on my hands. And if that wasn't enough, a few days later, I get an email from these guys. And when I'm opening this email, I'm expecting a thank you, because foreigners are very courteous. But when I actually opened it and I read this email, I was speechless. This was an email, an official email from Columbia Business School, where they were asking me, Munaf, can we do a case study on the Bohri kitchen? The problem statement we want to try and address is, if something this outstanding that could compete with an experience like a visit to the Taj Mahal in Agra, how is it not known to other foreigners? How is this not all over the place? How does the concept of home dining experience, why has it not penetrated and competed with the biggest tourist attractions in the country? Moments like this keep me up at night. How do you make home dining experiences a tourism asset? How do you enable this at scale? How do you create 100 TBKs? And asking myself this question allowed me to stumble into a fantastic individual by the name of Kea Khanwate. She's sitting out there and blushing. Kea, she committed a similar blunder as me. She decided very stupidly to quit her thriving career at McKinsey as a consultant to pursue her dreams. And she became, and she, her dream was to travel around the world. So she decided to enable that dream by becoming a travel consultant. And she's a travel consultant to the who's who in the country, the Adanis, the Tatas and whatnot. So I think she makes more money there than she did in McKinsey. But one of the coolest things that she's done, and she's really understood the pulse of how tourism works, she challenged the misconception that a mother can't travel with her son across the globe. Her son today is an Instagram celebrity. Why? Because he's visited over 24 countries, 27 countries, okay, across the globe. He's 6 years old. Me and Kea have the same problem statement. How do you activate home dining experiences into a tourism asset? And both of us, having a slightly analytical bent of mind, we operate on facts. A recent survey by the UNWTO, according to a recent survey, 88% of the members of the UNWTO said that gastronomy is strategic to the image of a destination. You would think that a tourist cares about the bed he's going to sleep on. You would think he cares about what he sees outside his window. He doesn't want to see a slum. He doesn't want to see garbage. You would think he cares about the temperature and the weather in a country more than he cares about food. We are wrong. He either cares about food as much or he cares about food even more. You know why? Because he eats twice a day in the country he visits. It's with this in mind that Australia in 2015 spent more than $8.5 million on a campaign that was titled Inviting the World to Dinner. Imagine that. Okay, 7.1 million tourists, a 6% uplift because of the campaign. Tourists who were surveyed in Australia ranked Australia as number one when it came to food because of this campaign. Spain, I just came back from Spain. Spain believes in culinary tourism to such an extent that they've literally created a word for it. It's called enogastronomy, food and wine culture. They made a chef of a small little restaurant in a small little city in Spain, which none of us have heard of, into their tourism ambassador. It's actually, there's a case study on it. It's called the El Bulli phenomenon. El Bulli is the name of this restaurant. They made the theme of their campaign, if you like to eat, come to Spain. It's as simple as it gets. This is why Spain today is top four when it comes to tourism destinations in the world. There's this one quote which really summarizes the importance of a home dining experience for tourism. If you really want to make a friend, go to someone's house and eat with them. The people who give you their food give you their heart. Visit a home dining experience and you'll understand, or just talk to my parents and you'll understand what that means. This is me and my fiance, she's in the audience, so I have to embarrass her. We literally last week came back from Spain and France. We found ourselves driving hundreds of kilometers because we read on TripAdvisor somewhere that, hey, you have to visit this cafe in Girona because it's the experience you have to go to. You have to visit this cultural immersion in Carcassonne. I can't even pronounce it. Because you just have to go there. We drove, we spent money, we expended energy on a limited time in Europe. And I realized something, that as a tourist myself, or as any traveler, as any tourist, we go out of our way to experience something that we can take back with us. It's not about eating food at a good restaurant, it's about eating food at an outstanding restaurant. It's about going back home and telling your parents, telling your family, making a presentation on stage about an outstanding experience you had, so people look up to you. That is what a home dining experience can do. But the real question is TBK a one-off? Is it a fluke? Can you really create 100 TBKs in Maharashtra? The answer to this question is you can create 1,000. Maharashtra single-handedly can probably compete with Spain and Australia when it comes to culinary tourism. Imagine a Kohli housewife, you know, inviting 7-8 foreigners to her house, sitting down with them, telling them about Kohli culture and heritage, talking to them about her husband who's probably out to sea fishing, talking about how she wakes up early in the morning to sell fish at the docks. And at the end of that conversation, she actually ends up feeding her client some authentic Kohli seafood. I mean, it's making my mouth water. Imagine what the foreigner, how they would react. Imagine a Pathare Prabhu housewife. There are barely 6,000 Pathare Prabhu members in this city, in the state today. This was the original community that used to work with the British. They owned the largest tracts of land in our state. Imagine she talks about how within the community, men and women are treated as equal ever since the origin of the community. These are revolutionary thoughts and conversations. Imagine at the end of all of that, she talks about food. She talks about how when they cook seafood, they only do it on flat-bottomed vessels. They never mix, they never stir, they never shake their food because they don't want the fish to crack. Nibbles of conversation like this are far more valuable to a tourist than the jewelry they buy on the roads of India. Because this is the conversation they will take back with them and they will re-discuss with their family when they go home. Maharashtra has an infinite number of microcultures like this that can be tapped in our 30 districts. But how do you do this? It's not easy. How do you create an ecosystem for home dining experiences when it doesn't exist? I and KIA can't do this alone. It's too challenging. Any private enterprise can't do this alone. You need the government support to be able to create an ecosystem like this. And you need the government support, and that's why Mr. VK Gautam's been invaluable, because with his optimism and his, literally he's become our shoulder of support to help us drive this. You need support on two fronts. It's not a simple kind of support. You need support on the demand side. How do you generate awareness amongst foreigners that there is something called a home dining experience? That's a credible thing. How do you introduce it within the regulatory framework so it's actually a legal, successful, scalable kind of thing to do? How do we take the Kohli housewife to London so she can cook food for foreigners and conduct a festival out there so we can spread awareness for this cuisine? But we also need tremendous support on the supply side. How do we challenge the mindset of 1,000 housewives that, hey, just because you've been sitting at home, raising your children, feeding them, talking about culture as a very simple thing in your family, just because you've been doing that, it doesn't mean you can't wake up tomorrow and become an entrepreneur, just like my mother did. We need to train them, we need to challenge that mindset, we need to make them understand what the potential for that culture and that cuisine is. And this is the second last slide. As I stand in front of you today, representing this idea of home dining experiences, I can't I wouldn't be able to do this, I wouldn't be on the stage unless for support from some fantastic people. I would like to thank the tourism minister of Maharashtra, Mr. Rawal, for his support. He actually took a presentation from KR on this idea. Mr. Fadnavis, the Honorable Chief Minister of Maharashtra, he worked overtime to listen to KR on her ideas around home dining. And finally, and most importantly, Mr. Gautam, who met us at CCD, I think, 100 times to make us understand that this is something we can actually do and it's not a pipe dream. And just to wrap this up, I know you all are bored of me. I just would like to say that I really hope, I sincerely hope that I and KR, we are welcome back on the stage maybe a year from now. But one thing should have changed. HomeDiningExperiences.com should have gone live. Thank you.